Hi everyone, I want to welcome you to our Organic Chemistry 2 lab. You might be wondering, how do I write a good formal lab report? Well, today I'm going to give you a few tips, and this will help you to get a good grade in the lab. Let's first of all look at the format of your report. So the format of your report should have title cover page, the abstract, the introduction, the experimental, the results and discussion, any assigned questions, the references, and the appendices. Next, you want to look at the style and presentation of your report. So the lab report should be word processed, nicely typed up. It should be double spaced with 1-inch margins. You want to make sure the pages are numbered. You want to use either Arial or Times New Roman font. You want to make sure that your sections are clearly labeled, like for your abstract, your introduction, your experimental, and so on. You want to ensure that you have the correct significant figures and units. You want to use the proper symbols and accepted acronyms. And you want to ensure that you have used the appropriate scientific communication. Let's look at the title page. What should it include? You should have the experimental title, your full name, the date the experiment was submitted, your instructor's name. What should it not include? Please do not add any decorative graphics that's not related to the experiment. The abstract, what does that look like? The abstract should always be written last, since the entire report basically is summed up in the abstract. So there are three important questions you want to ask yourself. The first is, what was done? The next is, how was it done? And the third, what were the results? So let's look at an example to make this point. So here is a sample abstract. It says that benzoic acid, 4-bromoaniline, and transthilbene were separated from each other using acid-base chemistry reactions. Their identities were confirmed by IR, TLC, and melting point analyses. So let's look at the three questions. What was done? Benzoic acid, 4-bromoaniline and transthilbene were separated from each other. So there's a separation going on. The question is, how was it done? Using acid-base chemistry reactions. What were the results? Their identities were confirmed by IR, TLC, and melting point. So that's how you would write your abstract. Now let's look at the introduction. Your introduction should include any relevant background or theory. It should have a hypothesis, the purpose for the experiment, figures, structures of different chemical reaction, the mechanism if it's known beforehand. It should not include anything that's irrelevant or technique that is used in the experiment. It should not include the results. And also, you want to avoid any personal feelings about the experiment. It doesn't matter if you like this experiment or you hate this experiment, just leave that out. So here's an example of an introduction. So this introduction talks about salicylic acid, which is found in the willow tree bark, and it was used as a source of like a pain reliever or fever. The problem, however, was it was very bitter in taste and it irritated the stomach. By simply making a derivative of salicylic acid, which is also or otherwise known as aspirin, this product was found to be less bitter and less irritating on the stomach. And if you look on the second paragraph, you'll see the role that these pharmaceutical has played. Or organic chemists have developed these pharmaceutical products and have improved on their properties so that they can be used as medicine. The last paragraph will cover an outline of what was done. So here you see in this experiment, acetyl salicylic acid was synthesized by an acid-catalyzed esterification of acetic anhydride and salicylic acid. And the reaction mechanism is the same as the Fischer esterification reaction. So the introduction, it gives you some background information, and then it kind of focuses on what was done in the experiment. So that's how I'd like you guys to write your introduction. And then let's look, if you have any relevant equation, as shown here, the reaction of salicylic acid with acetic anhydride that produces aspirin and the byproduct acetic acid, that's what you want to include for any relevant equation. Now let's look at the experimental. Your experimental should have a nice paragraph format that's written in the past tense. It's you're describing what was done, so you want to avoid words like I or we. You want to write it so that someone can look at your work and repeat the experiment. You want to ensure that you use for the mass volumes or moles of chemicals used, you want to have those in parentheses after the chemical names. For what should not be included, you want to avoid adding an equipment list, any slang of any kind, any description of the calculation, and again, nothing personal. Here's an example of an experimental. It says here to salicylic acid, notice in parentheses, you have the quantity that was used and the units. The units is in gram. It's written in the past tense. For acetic anhydride, it shows you in parentheses that the volume 1 mL was used, and it continues all the way down to where it speaks of the dark brown contents of the vial were poured into a test tube containing ice water. So this is just a guide of how to write your experimental in the past tense, utilizing the masses, the volumes, have those in parentheses and have it nicely written. In terms of the results should have neatly labeled tables. Any relevant observations, what should not be included? You want to include an interpretation of the data beyond what's in the table. You don't want to add discussion or conclusions or any spectral printout. You don't want to add anything about how you felt about this experiment. You just want to keep it the way it should be. So just to summarize, your results should pretty much give a summary of the data collected and its statistical treatment. It should include any relevant data, but give enough detail to justify your conclusions. You should use equations and figures as required for clarity and conciseness. So here's an example of a results section. You notice in table one, it has reactants and products. For the reactants and products, you have information, their molecular formula, their densities, the quantities used, their molecular weights, the molar amounts that were used, any physical properties like their melting point, boiling point. And if you have to do a melting point of your product, let's say you have a melting point of 137 to 139 in your experiment, you want to compare that to the literature value. And that kind of tells you how pure your sample is. So you want to all make sure that you include those relevant information. Now let's take a look at the discussion. So you want to be objective in your discussion. You want to point out features and limitations of your work. You want to make the appropriate inferences from the results section. You want to relate the discussion to the purpose of the project. Did you achieve what you had set out to accomplish? And for the conclusion, you want to make sure that it's based on the evidence presented. So the conclusion is like you're finishing everything up. You're just summing up everything. You want to repeat the key conclusion from the discussions section. You want to look at future work, potential error analysis. What you do not want to do is to do a repeat of your discussion or make generic conclusions. You don't want to introduce any new results that were not previously mentioned, and again, no personal feelings. Okay? So here's an example of a discussion slash conclusion. It says salicylic acid was synthesized from an acid catalyzed esterification of acetic anhydride and salicylic acid. It talks about the mechanism as being the same as the Fischer esterification. It talks about the yield, the melting point range, compare that to the literature value, and that suggests that your product was made and it's of high purity. Let's keep going. In terms of acknowledgement, you want to thank those persons who helped you along the way, your lab mates, your teammates. You'll also acknowledge the lab mentor, the instructor, those persons who helped to make this work a success. Give them thanks. Now let's look at the references. For references, you want to always make sure you use the American Chemical Society style format. So I'm going to give you a few examples of references of different types. The first is a reference from a journal, like the Journal of American Chemical Society. You want to make sure that the year is in bold, the volume is italicized, followed by the page number, the author's name are listed before. Number two is an example of a reference from a textbook. You want to make sure that you include the publisher of the textbook, where they're located, and the title of the text. For the third example, here's a lab manual that was published at the University of Tampa. So you want to make sure you pay special details to the important points. And lastly, for a reference that was obtained from the web, you want to make sure you include the authors, the title, the URL in terms of the web page or the website where you got that information, and also, but more importantly, the date when this information was accessed. Finally, you want to include any supporting information in the appendices section. So any IR spectra, NMR spectra, GC spectra, or any other important data, make sure you add those at the end. Is that all right? And last but by no means least, you want to turn in your completed lab report on time. Do not say that the iguana ate it. That will not be acceptable. Turn in your lab report on time so you can get a great and excellent grade. Until then, I'll see you next time.